Good afternoon and welcome back. Today is a great day to go out and do some sighting in with a rifle, with a scoped rifle. It's bright and sunny out, just the slightest breeze. That shouldn't bother us too much at 100 yards. We'll still be careful though, because even a breeze at 100 yards can have some influence on a varmint bullet. But there are just a few things that we need to get prepared. First of all, you need to have a well-mounted scope rifle. And when I say well-mounted, you can see my previous video, how to mount a scope on a rifle. I suggest that you do that before proceeding any farther, because that's key. If your scope isn't properly mounted, then you're going to have nothing but problems. You're just simply not going to be able to sight your rifle in correctly. And in that video, I also explained how to do it without any additional regalia. You don't need to buy additional components, and you don't have to buy lapping instruments or anything like this. You know, scopes have been mounted for many, many decades with the simplest tools, with nothing more than a screwdriver, and that's all you need. Don't let anybody tease you into thinking that you have to have expensive, fancy gunsmithing gadgetry, because gunsmiths never used that themselves. This is a recent phenomenon. Guns, the way they're drilled and tapped these days, and the way scope mounts are made, and the way the scopes themselves are made with such precision, everything just we shouldn't even call it mounting anymore. It's really attaching a scope. It's no more than simply attaching it. The days of mounting a scope, when a gunsmith had to be involved with drilling and tapping, and sometimes there were issues with alignment, those days are pretty much gone now forever, thank God. Now, just a few other things that you need to have with you besides your rifle and scope. You should always sight in on a very, very sturdy bench. A bench that's solid and rigid. Now, it's perfectly all right if it's a portable bench. But as long as it's good and rigid, you don't want to have a table that sways around every time you breathe. That's going to foil your best attempts at sighting in. And don't go by the line, well, the gun's going to shoot better than me, because that's not the point. You want to be able to know that the rifle is always pointing and shooting in the same place. The next thing is you need a good rest. Now you can use a bipod. There's nothing. I personally don't use a bipod because I don't use one in the field. It's just too heavy for me to carry around when I can shoot just as well without it. You know, the standard military positions, or perhaps if I'm shooting long distance, I'll throw a rolled up cotton cloth in my bag or something like that, and use that as a temporary rest. But whether you have that or not, that's fine. But don't use wooden blocks. You know, you don't want to use anything that's hard and rigid under your gun stock, even if they're carpeted and things like that. You want to have something that's resilient. You know, a bipod is by its nature resilient because it gives a spring loaded and it gives with the recoil, and there's some resilience. So the gun interacts with the bipod in a very normal way. And furthermore, you're sighting in with the same gun that you're going to be shooting all the time. So that way there's a uniformity that is immediately present. But if you're using a rifle without a bipod, which is the way I do it and the way I'll demonstrate, you really need to have a semi-soft, but resilient fore-end rest that you can mount, that you can lay your fore-end stock on, and also a resilient but firm, possibly a rabbit ear bag, but you can do all sorts of makeshift things. You can just simply roll up. You can roll up a towel and bind it with tape, you know, with tape if you want, or string, and those things will suffice. Plenty of people have simply taken a couple of big beach towels and rolled them up tightly, and bound them with string or duct tape, and used that as a fore-end rest. That's fine. If you can afford it, and if you like to do a lot of shooting over a bench, I certainly suggest that you invest in a nice tripod. What I don't recommend is one of the new shooting cradles. Shooting cradles are something that really defy all common sense with shooting. They're not something you can carry into the field. Shooting cradles do provide precision, adjustable rest for your rifle while you're sighting in. The only problem being is that they do not provide the same sort of rest that you will have in the field. In other words, they don't have the same flip at the muzzle. They oftentimes restrain the gun so that it can't recoil naturally. They interfere with the way you cradle the gun in your arms, and all these things which contribute to accuracy in the field. The most important thing with accuracy in the field is to replicate the same type of shooting behavior every single time. Resting your stock in the field, if you rest your stock on your hand like this, then you should make sure that your rifle is rested close to the receiver as you're sighting it in. If you shoot more often this way, then you want to be sure that your stock is rested halfway back, about halfway through, in the middle of the checkering, which is about standard practice, because that will accommodate pretty much any type of hold that you have. Most rifles these days have free-floated barrels, and the barrels can simply vibrate on their own, which is a very good thing. Make sure that your barrel is, if it's supposed to be free-floated, make sure that it has free clearance all the way. The traditional thing to do has been to take a dollar bill and slide it up and down between the wood stock and the barrel. I think that's a little bit less than is necessary. If you're using a dollar bill, I would say double it, or at least use two or three thicknesses of paper that you can, or a matchbook cover. The standard thing for me is to make sure that the gun will accept a matchbook cover all the way from top to bottom, from floor end to the back. Now, certain guns don't have that sort of mounting provision. Many times, for instance, a Remington 700 very frequently will be mounted into the stock with firm floor-end pressure. That's pretty much standard throughout the industry for many different guns, especially with wood stock rifles. That firm upward pressure can provide extremely good accuracy. The only caveat being is that it can change, especially if it's a wood stock. It can change from day to day with varying humidity conditions. And it can cause the barrel to have differences in upward pressure. So whatever you do, try to maintain uniformity. If you're going for a free floated barrel, keep it free floated. If you're going with the standard fore end pressure that is oftentimes provided with stocks, make sure that pressure stays pretty consistent all the time. One of the ways that you can do that is to be sure to take the action out and make sure that the inside of the stock is appropriately coated with waterproof urethane. And you don't have to get too elaborate about it. It's just basically a matter of keeping excess moisture out of that barrel channel. Chances are with a high-powered rifle with a varmint barrel, you're really going to be out on nice days, so it's not going to be that big an issue. And if you're one of the owners of a more contemporary gun with a fiberglass stock and things like that, it's not a concern whatsoever. Uniformity, just always remember that word, uniformity from shot to shot. Everything, if it's uniform, will go better. So again, I don't recommend any kind of shooting cradle, especially the adjustable ones and sleds and all these things, because there's nothing that you can possibly do to replicate the type of shooting that you will have in the field. Your gun will not respond the same, and they're simply not as comfortable to shoot around. You're basically shooting a machine. It's not a rifle anymore. With many of them, you mount the rifle into the sled. You tighten down the wing nuts or the screws, and then you just basically pull the trigger. And it's very impassionate. There's nothing like shooting a rifle off your shoulder. If you're sighting in a rifle which has got heavy recoil, You can use what, you know, and this is no slight on anybody, but the old term is you can use a sissy bag. A sissy bag is nothing more than you go down to the local bank and you ask the cashier, the bank manager, if you can have a money sack. And those make terrific gun rests. You fill them with sand or fine lead shot, and if you're making a sissy bag, you can just sew one up or tie it up and just put it against your shoulder. Five pounds of shot between you and your gun stock, even if it's only 3/4 inch thick, won't interfere much with your sighting, but it will add 5 pounds of rifle weight and will dramatically reduce the recoil and spread it out around a broad area too. Those are things that you can do. I can guarantee you that you can shoot the most hefty gun on the planet if you take a 25-pound bag of bird shot and mount it between you and the rifle. It really will suck up all the recoil. So those are things you can do if you're sighting in a heavy recoiling rifle. Don't misunderstand. Shooting a heavy recoiling rifle can be very, very different sitting at a bench than it is when you're sitting at a normal shooting position where your whole body can move. Sitting at a bench and you're anchored beside the gun, it's a lot more distasteful and it can wrap you in the cheek. So these are things to have with you. I recommend strongly that you get a few sight-in targets. You're not going to need many. One or two is going to be all you'll need, but you need to have one or two sight-in targets for each of the rifles that you're going to be sighting in. When I say a sight-in target, now I'm talking about the large ones that are made by Hoppies and different companies, you know, Redfield, Loophole. They all make printed targets that have 1-inch fine 1-inch squares throughout them, and they have different patterns which are set up so that they can be easily positioned with a scope crosshair or other sort of reticle. So that you'll need. And the reason you need the squares is very simply because from a distance when you're looking, whether it's through a set of binoculars or whether you can see it with your scope or even your naked eye, you want to be able to measure off how many minutes of angle you need to move your scope crosshairs, your reticles, to make adjustments. Each of those squares is 1 MOA, in other words, 1 inch. So set it 100, the target is intended to be set at 100 yards, generally speaking. And if you set it at 100 yards, you know that each one of those squares represents 1 inch. It's very, very easy to count them using a spotting scope or your telescope or whatever it is, or even a pair of binoculars. Very simple. And always pick a day when there's little to no breeze. You don't want to be chasing bullets around the paper with gusty wind. And I'll discuss how to deal with certain little facts about the weather, because you know you can always adjust your shooting conditions for sighting in day, but it's very, very difficult to adjust your shooting conditions when you're out hunting. I mean, you get what you got, and you have to be able to read the wind. But reading the wind is not something you want to be doing while you're sighting in. You want to have all the advantages in your square. You want to make sure that everything that you do is a positive movement towards getting your gun sighted in. You know, I've seen, and you've seen it too, people go to the range with 2 or 3 boxes of ammo and they're there for 3 hours trying to sight in their gun, and they're really frustrated by the process. And unfortunately, it's simply because they didn't understand the rather simple process that it is and how to accommodate it. The very first thing you have to know is at what trajectory do you want to set your telescope crosshairs. You know, I'll show you a demonstration on the computer that you can find. If you're watching this, you certainly have a computer and you have access to the internet. And there are other traditional ways. You know, if you have a nozzler or a Sierra loading handbook, which I strongly recommend that everybody have, simply because you can read up about different cartridges. You can pick on the back page of this nozzle book the exact ballistic coefficient that your bullet is. This doesn't go by caliber, or cartridge designation. It goes by ballistic coefficient. So if you have, for instance, I'm shooting a Sometimes I shoot a 257 Roberts. I know that that's a, with the bullet that I use, an 85 grain bullet, that happens to be a bullet with a ballistic coefficient of 0.329. So all I need to do is turn to a page where it says ballistic coefficient of 329. You can see up here it says ballistic coefficients of 0.320 to 329. Can you see that right there at the top of the page? And if you read down the side of it, you'll see that it lists various muzzle velocities. And the muzzle velocities are right in this column right here. And it will state, I just look for the velocity that I know that my rifle is shooting at the muzzle. So I happen to know that one particular load is shooting at 3250 from my rifle. So there is no 3250, but there's a 3200 and there's a 3300. So it's going to be whatever numbers that are expressed in this chart are going to be right directly between those. You're going to extrapolate that information easily from reading between them. But so it's just simply a matter of going through across the column, and you'll see that there are different sight in distances. So you can sight in at zeros at 100 yards, 200 yards, 300, 400, out to 500 yards. That's about the longest practical range that is given here. If you go beyond that, you're on your own. You're probably doing something a little bit more sophisticated if you're shooting beyond 500 yards. So this is basic information that will give you all the data on the bullet trajectory and also the bullet path. What is the difference between trajectory and bullet path? Well, the bullet trajectory is the actual arc of its flight through the line of sight. The raw bullet drop is if your barrel was held level with the surface of the earth where you're standing, the bullet drop occurs immediately as the bullet comes out of the barrel. As soon as gravity takes effect on that bullet, immediately when it emits from the barrel, then it immediately begins to fall away and go towards the ground. That's not how you sight in. That's not how you sight in a rifle, because obviously you'll never hit your target. Even the closest target is going to be below your bore line. What you need to do is you need to elevate your barrel such that it projects the bullet, it casts the bullet up through your line of sight, and it's going to cross that line of sight once. And then again, as it falls back down through, if the target is beyond the second occurrence, but the first time is going to be relatively close. So, for instance, let me just show you if I'm using a 3,200 foot per second bullet, then I'm going to be and say, for instance, I was sighting in at 200 yards, and that's not necessarily where I would sight in. But if I'm sighting in at 200 yards, then the arc of the trajectory at 100 yards is 1.3 inches. And the arc of trajectory at 300 yards is below the line of sight by 6.1 inches. So that's as easy as that. And if I go up to a zero of 300 yards, then the arc of trajectory places it at 3.3 inches above the line of sight at 100 yards. 4 inches above the line of sight at 200 yards, 0 at 300 yards, and then at 400 yards it's at a negative 10.2 inches. So as you can see, the arc of the trajectory can be adjusted to your liking, and it doesn't have to fall dead on 200 yards and 300 yards or any of these supposed points. You can adjust it to whatever suits you, and that's what I always recommend. And that's where it can be very beneficial to, rather than trying to guesstimate from charts like this where a bullet will fall in between, you can go directly to the computer, and there are several excellent sites that you can visit. One of them is a Hornady site, and I recommend that. Let's go there. Okay, so here we are at Hornady's ballistic calculator. Now on this sheet, you'll notice that it says standard of metric, so we'll use, if you're using United States system, you stick with standard. We'll use, you can use either basic or advanced mode. We'll stick with basic for the time being. You can always shift it over anytime you want. We're going to be sighting in a 22-250, so we'll go with that. And the next thing that we need to know is the ballistic coefficient. Now, if you don't know the ballistic coefficient of your bullet, it's very easy to go to, we'll flip to another website and we'll check it out. Okay, we're at the nozzle page and we've turned to the 22-250 page, and there's a 55 grain bullet listed with a ballistic tip, which is what I'm using, and it's a 55 grain spitzer ballistic tip, and it has a ballistic coefficient of 0.267. So all I do now, I could easily also use this page as a reference for my loading data, which is a handy thing to have without having to buy their book. But I can also go to back here to the ballistics calculator, and it was 0.267, and to 0.267, and my velocity, I know that the velocity of this particular load that I'm shooting, and I'll show you what the load is. I happen to be using Varget powder, and I'm using 31 grains, which is a mid-range load. It's a very low-speed load for a 22-250, but this would replicate a 223 bullet trajectory. This is 3273. The reason I'm using this particular load is because I just had cataract surgery in my right eye, and I can't be doing anything that would potentially give me some serious issues with the recovery and the healing of the eye. So I'm going to stick with a very mild load, 3273, but it's an accuracy load with 31 grains. But entering that data, you can see it's 3273 is the projected velocity with a 24-inch barrel, which is exactly what I have. So a 24-inch barrel, I can expect it to give me roughly the same velocities, which I can verify at some other time. So 3273, I simply enter that information, and the weight of the bullet is 55 grains, and I'm going to set my maximum range at 400 yards. In my entire life, I've shot very few prairie dogs beyond 350 yards or so, 400 yards. There are more issues than trajectory when you get at those ranges. At those ranges, the slightest breeze becomes a serious issue, and windage becomes more of a factor than trajectory at that range. So, for practical use, I'm going to stick to a 400 yard maximum range. And you got to know your countryside too. It's nice to talk about extended range shooting, but I live in New England, for instance, and the longest shot you're going to be offered at a woodchuck in a pasture in New England is somewhere around 225 yards. That would be a long shot. Corner to corner, you might find a couple of pastures that you're going to get 300 yards, 340 yards or something. But that's a rarity. You know, we've got undulating hills, and there's usually something between you and anything that distant. So we can set our maximum range of 400 yards and have plenty to work with. Interval 25 yards. I like to express my results in the finest increments possible. If they had 10 yards, I'd put it at 10 yards. Zero range, we don't know. But what I'm going to do is I'm going to guess that it's 230 yards. 230 with this particular load. That I don't know what the actual range will end up being. Sight height, that's pretty standard. 1.5 inches for most with most standard height mounts. Now, you know, if you're using a gun which has got extended height scope mounts, you're going to have to take a more careful measurement, because that sight height, that's the distance between the center of your bore line, the very center of the barrel, or the center of the receiver, up to the center of your crosshairs, in other words, the middle of your scope. It's a very easy figure to calculate, and I'm not going to get into that right now, but you should know what your actual scope height is above your above the bullet. Now, all I do now at this point is hit the calculate button, and all the numbers jump right up. Now, we can go right down through the chart, and you can see everything is set up in 25-yard increments. With a velocity of 3273 and an initial muzzle energy of 1,308 foot-pounds, I have a trajectory, as shows here, of minus 1.5, and that's very easy to understand. As the bullet's coming out of the barrel, it's exactly 1.5 inches below your crosshair. So your trajectory at the muzzle is 1.5 to the minus. Now, as you move farther down the chart, you can see at 25 yards, this is a significant number here. 25 yards is when it begins to approach the actual crossing point as the bullet is projecting up through the crosshairs. So it changes from a negative number between 25 yards and 50 yards, someplace in there. It changes from a negative number to a positive number, and it hits a zero. There is actually another zero between this range. So there are two zeros in any scope mounted sighting proposition. If you're sighted to zero at a distant range, you are also zeroed at a close range. And that's a very handy thing to know. If you happen to have a 30-06 or a 270 that's sighted in at a distant range, and you happen to be walking through the woods and notice that a partridge is walking in front of you or sitting in a low limb, you know, you can clean his head off by knowing this information without blowing him up. So if you know what the distance is where your crosshairs are centered, you also know that if you take note here, this is 25 yards, somewhere around maybe 28 yards or so, this bullet is crossing the center line. That would happen to be just about the ideal location if you're in the woods and you ran across something close by. You just aim exactly where you want to hit, and that's exactly where the bullet's going to go. You don't have to worry about hold over, hold under, or anything. So this number here translates very nicely to high-powered rifles, which you're using out in the field for hunting large game. But then when you're in the woods and you're shooting at close distances in close cover, you're also perfectly zeroed in at, say, 28 to 35 yards, depending on the rifle caliber and your trajectory. So now we're moving out. Now we know that if we want, we could easily get a very good idea of where our gun is shooting by putting a target out at 25 yards, which is what I recommend if you've never sighted in a rifle before, and I'll explain why. And as you move along down here now, we go back to our... We sighted in initially zero range, 230 yards, right here. So there is no 230, but there is a 250, and there is a 225, and so forth. But 100 yards, this is where we're going to put our target. We're 1.9 inches above the line of sight. That's all we need to know, is that today if we're going out and we're shooting and we want to have that rifle sighted in, we're going to make sure that our crosshair is 1.9 inches above the line of sight. Now, maybe that's not going to work out exactly the way we want. Maybe we want to shoot with a little bit higher midpoint trajectory because we want to have a little bit more extended range down the line. And we're working with larger targets than small prairie dogs or something like that, so we can have the bullet can strike with a woodchuck as much as 2.5 inches above and as low as 2.5 inches below the line of sight. I can creep out a little bit farther than that. The highest point in my trajectory right here is 2.2. So let's see if we can nudge it out to. We'll go back and we'll nudge it out to another 10 yards and see if that gets what we want. So we go to 240 yards, and if I go to 240 yards, we're right on the button now, 2.5 inches above midpoint trajectory, at the midpoint trajectory, two and a half inches above the line of sight at 150 yards. And then it's beginning to cruise back down at 175 yards, now it's 2.2. At 200 yards it's 1.6, 225, 0.7, and then at 250 it drops very slightly, just a half inch below the zero point at 250. And we're all the way out to almost 300 yards before it reaches 4.2 inches low. Now it's very easy if you know that your target is that distance to just simply hold a little bit on the favor the upside a little bit on your target, and you're still going to strike out to 300 yards. And remember, this is not a 22-250 load. This is a 223 load. This is the same trajectory in ballistics that you'll have with a 55 grain bullet traveling out of a standard length 223 barrel that's 24 inches long. So this is good information to know. If I were using a 22-250 load, I would be stretching it out much farther than this. But this is basically where I want to be. I'm taking out a woodchuck rifle. I want to be able to just hold point blank without favoring up, down, or anything else, all the way out to 260 yards, 240 yards rather, before it's at the line of sight, and then it will take it all the way out to nearly 300 yards, 275 yards and then some. It's probably about 280 yards, judging by this minus 2.2 at 275, another 5 yards, and probably another couple of tenths lower. So it's all the way up to 280 yards without any correction whatsoever. And if I want to shoot out to 300 yards and beyond, then I simply bring along this information in my head, or either just memorize it, or I can print this out and put it in my pocket. You can also put this into a cheat sheet, which will give you this information that you can tape on the side of your stock. So this will give you all your comeuppance. This will give you all the information that you need to come up in MOA. Now remember, MOA is not trajectory. MOA is an entirely different thing. MOA means 1 inch per 100 yards. So for every 100 yards, you're adding an additional inch. One MOA at 100 yards is 1 inch. One MOA at 200 yards is 2 inches. One MOA at 300 yards is 3 inches, and so forth, and any fraction thereof in between. So those are things you don't want to get confused about, and don't get them jumbled. I want to be sure that when I'm first sighted in, I'm very close. I should be just barely striking 0.2 inches below the zero at 25 yards. And remember, guns aren't that accurate. These are all theoretical numbers. What you're working with is the center of the impact points. In other words, in any given group of shots, usually defined by at least 3 shots, the center of that given group will define your theoretical center of your group. So that's what we're literally aiming for here, is the theoretical center of our group. So some of these shots might, one or two shots might be a little above this point, one or two shots may be a little bit below the point, and so forth, and that's it. I just want to illustrate to you how sensitive bullets are to wind. If we close this out and we add in a very, very small amount of wind, we have to first of all go to the advanced page, and a wind angle at 90 degrees, that is, in other words, flowing directly across the target. A wind angle of 90 degrees is called a full value wind. Full value wind means that you are getting the effect of every ounce of breeze. So we'll set the wind speed at just 2.5 miles per hour. That would be the kind of wind that would barely flutter leaves on a tree. That would be a nice mild breeze as we're having today. And we'll just see what that does to the calculations that we've set. And all of a sudden now our wind drift in inches appears. At 100 yards, we have to be conscious of the fact that A group can open by as much as 0.3 inches, can be affected by as much as 0.3 inches. In other words, a third of an inch, roughly a third of an inch at 100 yards. So if we're shooting for groups on a day like this, and if the wind is blowing directly from the side, either from 3 o'clock or from 9 o'clock, that's going to open up our group. And that's enough to be a third of a minute of angle. So that can affect group size. So when you have a breezy day, it adds a little bit of a challenge to be shooting in a wind. If you happen to be shooting at 250 yards on a day like today, or we'll even go as far as 275 yards on a day like today, you're moving your bullet over the wind that's blowing at 3 o'clock or 9 o'clock at only 2.5 miles per hour, a very, very mild, gentle breeze, is blowing that bullet a full 2 inches, and at 300 yards, 2.5 inches. If we move all the way out to 400 yards, you're moving way off target on any woodchuck. You're moving at 4.8 inches. That's almost 5 inches right off the target. So you can see how sensitive wind issues are. Let's go to a more typical wind that you'll find if you're shooting out in the prairie. If you happen to be shooting after the sun has been up for a couple of hours out in Wyoming and you're out in the middle of a back prairie, you can very, very easily have wind speeds of 15 miles per hour. That occurs daily. And so if you have a wind speed of 15 miles per hour, it really becomes exciting challenges to shoot at anything beyond just even close range. At 150 yards, you have a wind drift of 3.5 inches. At 175 yards, you're way off target. You've got a wind drift of 4.9 inches. And when you get out to 350 yards, you hear people talk about how they shoot at 350 yards all the time. Well, I take that with a grain of salt because, see, wind drifts are out to almost 22 inches at 350 yards, and they're 2 feet off and getting close to you're getting close to 3 feet off when you get out to 400 yards. These are serious issues with regard to wind. So always keep wind uppermost in your consideration whenever you're shooting. Now, just as a matter of illustration, a full value wind is blowing this direction here from side to side across your target. If it happens to be blowing, it's moving from your shoulder in either direction or toward your shoulder in either direction, that's called a half value wind. A quarter value wind is one that falls between full value and half value. Now that could either be from way back near your cheek towards the target, or it can be from either cheek, or it can be towards your cheek at a quartering angle. A zero value wind is a wind which blows directly towards the target or towards you. There is no theoretical number associated with a zero value wind. So these numbers right here, you can apply that. So if you have your cheat sheet attached to your stock, and you happen to be shooting at a distance of 275 yards at a antelope, and the wind is blowing directly at your back or directly at from the target, that 12 turns into a zero, so you don't have to be concerned about the wind. And you can adjust your position with respect to the game, which is one of the things that's highly recommended, if it's possible. In other words, if you can use ground cover, hills and valleys, to make adjustments in your position between the wind and the target, that's very much advised if you're taking a long shot, because you certainly don't want to have a shot blow off target and miss a good opportunity, or worse yet, to hit him in a non-vital spot and really cause some destruction to the bowels, where you'd have a mess or possibly cause a cripple. But these are all things that you can keep in mind. So if you have a half value wind, which is blowing from your shoulder or towards your shoulder, then you divide these numbers in half. If it's a quarter value, divide them by four and take that number. So everything is very, very easy to kind of calculate in your head if you just have an idea of what the wind speed is and the distance you are and how it's flowing from or toward you. So we've established that we're going to have our trajectory sighted so it's at zero at 25 yards. We're going to be out to at 100 yards sitting at the bench, and that's going to place our bullet at 2.1 inches above. The center of our group should be 2.1 inches above the center of the target. In other words, what we'll do is we will center the crosshair directly on the middle of the target, and we'll fire the shots, and we'll fire three at any given time, and then we will see where those three shots landed, and then make scope adjustments accordingly. But before we begin that, we will also be setting up, before we even go to 100 yards, we will be setting up at 25 yards to fire just one shot. That's all that's necessary. I'll show you how we're going to first of all set up our scope, and then we're going to fire just one test shot at 25 yards to see where that shot lands on paper so that we can be assured that we have a group at 100 yards and that we're not chasing bullets off the paper. I've seen that so often. I've seen people put targets out at 100 yards, and with a gun that's never been sighted in before, they attempt to fire shots, and they're looking for shots on the paper, and their buddy is telling them, well, shoot 2 feet off to the right-hand side, no, it's not hitting there. Shoot 2 feet off the left-hand side, no, it's not hitting there. Shoot 2 feet off the top of the target, and so forth, and they have no idea, and they go through a half a box of ammo just before they can figure out that they can't find the bullet. So it's very important to just set up the target at 25 yards, fire one shot, then you'll have a very good indication as to where you need to move your crosshair, and you'll make a very gross adjustment. And there's no need to fire three shots at 25 yards, because at 25 yards, even a gun which is shooting 4 MOA is going to be shooting only a 1-inch group. So it's of little consideration to shoot groups at 25 yards. So that's it. Let's move on, and we'll explain what we're doing with the gun and scope. Before we move on, remember that the height above the ball line, your midpoint trajectory, should be based upon the game that's being sought. It should be in concert with the size of the animal's kill zone. So if we're talking about woodchuck size varmints, we're talking about a target which may at times be laying down very frequently. They don't sometimes stand up. They just sometimes will just lay there and feed. And as they're laying there, they're approximately 6 inches tall, top to bottom. The kill zone is roughly about inside an inch of that on both, half inch of that on both sides. It doesn't take much of a hit on a woodchuck or any other varmint to really put them out. You got a lot of speed going on, a lot of velocity, and it's a very small animal. Even the largest varmints will succumb quickly to a well-placed body hit. But a target kill zone of approximately 5 inches gives me 2.5 inches above and 2.5 inches below. And if he's standing up, certainly I have a lot more to work with. But if I'm working with a coyote, now I'm talking about a kill zone which is from 8 to 10 inches. I'd rather keep it around 8 inches in order to be sure, because some coyotes are rather small. And the kill zone is not necessarily all the way from their back to their belly, because you can easily hit low on the belly or high on the back and have a wounded coyote that won't necessarily go down and will run off on you. They'll die. They're certainly mortally hit, but you don't want to have that situation. So if you can, I would say stay with the smaller number. 8 inches will give you a 4 inches above and 4 inches below trajectory, and that's, you know, unless you've got a really a pipsqueak, rifle, you're going to get out to a long, long range with that sort of trajectory. You're going to be able to adjust that, as I showed you on this paper here. You'll be able to adjust that and get out to 350, even 400 yards just fine. And that's, again, we're talking about wind and the conditions that prevail and everything. Coyotes are always on the move. They're frisky critters. They're always darting around. They move from one place to another briskly, and they don't present an awful easy target at any range, let alone let alone extended ranges beyond 100 yards on moving targets. So, you know, all those things in consideration. We're very, very rarely going to see such a well-camouflaged animal that takes cover so effectively and moves and uses cover all his life to stay secret from the rest of the environment. You're very rarely going to get an open shot on a coyote at extended ranges where he's going to be just standing there like grazing like a deer. That's very, very, very rare. So with a coyote, you're talking approximately an eight-inch box that you're shooting into. A deer, generally speaking, a deer is a 10 to 12 inch box that you're going to be shooting into. I have found it very, very rare that you're going to be shooting, even at plains game, much beyond 350 yards. You know, considering the wind, the undulating hills that you typically find in those areas where mule deer are found and things like that. Most of the shots that have been presented to me have been someplace between 150 to 175 yards out to maybe 325 yards on tops on mule deer, and on antelope 350 to 400 yards is about as far out as I've ever had an opportunity to shoot at an antelope. And a 400 yard shot on an antelope, you know, is an extremely long shot, especially when the wind is, it virtually howls many times of the day throughout the West. So all those things basically point to having a 10 to 12 inch box window to shoot into. So you're talking about a midpoint trajectory of no more than about 6 inches high with a if you're taking a 270 out, and you know it can be less than that and you'll be fine. And if you're talking about much larger game, if you're talking about elk-sized animals, you know, you can increase that to as much as 15 to 16 inch kill zone, and that will give you a half of that is 8 inches above and 8 inches below. Now you're getting into other situations. Now you're getting into, again, you know, long wind drift. You start getting into these enticing ranges that are way out there. And, you know, wind drift can very seriously cripple a very, very highly valued animal that you won't recover. Keep that stuff in mind. You know, in this neighborhood, moose hunting in Quebec is not, you know, you're talking about open tundra. These animals, and in Alaska too, you're talking about animals that are moving about. They're very infrequently shot at very extended ranges. They're seen at extended ranges, but usually by the time somebody gets down into their level where they're actually hunting them, sometimes the target is much, much closer, sometimes within rock throwing distance, because it's thick country, and that's just the way it is. So oftentimes from extended heights looking down, you might see a moose, you know, 1,000 yards away that you work up on, and at that point then, you know, it's a matter of dealing with the same brush and thick cover that he's in. So all those things, but regulate your sight in trajectory at a standard which accommodates the game that you're seeking. There's absolutely nothing wrong. You don't have to shoot into 12-inch kill zones if you're sighting in your 30-06. There's absolutely nothing wrong with sighting it in with a, you know, 2.5-inch midpoint trajectory, a 4-inch midpoint trajectory. If you know that you're always going to be hunting and taking your shots inside 250 to 300 yards, there's absolutely nothing wrong whatsoever with adjusting your trajectory so that it falls at a slightly flatter trajectory at closer ranges rather than a more curved parabola. A parabola is a curve which increases in the radius quickly reduces as the velocity drops. So at the initial point of the trajectory, it starts out shooting rather straight and true, but then as the velocity begins to drop, also the bullet curvature towards the earth accelerates, and so that's your parabola. It's not a constant radius curve. So a midpoint trajectory is not directly midpoint of the rifle bore and the zero point. It's in between, but it's generally, the midpoint is generally at a point where it is, it's simply the highest point that it reaches between you and the target, but it's going to be not directly in the middle. It's going to be farther toward the target than it is toward you. So that's it. So we're going to be sighting in, today I'm going to be sighting in this particular rifle. What you want to do is make sure that your crosshairs are true to the gun and level. Make sure again that the scope is solidly mounted. You want to have absolutely no, any movement whatsoever is a waste of time. You just cannot sight in a rifle where the scope is improperly mounted. And you can't sight in a gun that has an inexpensive cheap scope where the crosshairs can't settle down. If you've got a scope that has crosshairs that just won't settle down, there are a lot of inexpensive scopes, no matter how much adjustments they take, they just won't settle down and they won't stay put. So that's not what we're dealing with today. We're dealing with, I presume that you've got a good quality scope. The first thing we're going to do is we're going to remove the turrets. Now this one here happens to have side focus, which is a parallax adjusting knob, and that parallax adjustment is the same as having the objective lens adjustment. If you have an objective lens adjustment on a scope, it accommodates the same thing. It does exactly the same thing. It's just in a different location. It happens to be a little handier to reach, but other than that, it works exactly the same way. So if you remember, if you're going to be sighting in at first at 25 yards, you'll be turning that to the 25 yard point, and then when you move out to 100 yards, you're going to be setting it to 100. So those are the things that you're going to be doing at the range. But for the time being, I want to take the turrets off, the turret caps, I should say, and I want to center my reticle. Now, centering the reticle simply means that I optically center it. In the old days, back in the 50s, before scopes were sophisticated, a great many scopes had you could see the crosshairs move back and forth, up and down in the scope lens. It was not uncommon to have scope reticles radically off center from the optical middle. The crosshairs could be way up at the corner. I've seen that. It was kind of a distressing issue, and it usually related to a poor mounting job by the gunsmith who drilled the screw holes. For whatever reason, it was just not holding a zero at the middle of the optical center. Nowadays, we have optically centered crosshairs, which don't appear to move inside the scope tube body. Rather, the lenses themselves move so that all the adjustments remain to your eye. They remain stationary, but they are moving within the scope tube body that you just don't, it's not being presented to you visually. So, to center, what we want to do is center the, find the point where the crosshairs are centered. To do that, just simply turn your turret all the way down clockwise until you reach the bottom. Now, don't force it. You want to just simply come to a dead stop, but don't force it. When it comes comfortably to a stop, stop right there. Now, using whatever indicator you can. In this case here, I've got the coin slot. There's a slot here that's designed to fit a penny or a dime. I can take that and count the revs, count the revolutions around until I get to the very other stop. So I'm gonna count. I got 1, 2, 3, 4. I got 4 and a quarter. So I got 4 and a quarter turns from stop to stop. That means the center is somewhere around just a little over 2. So I want to go back 2 full turns. I want to go One, two, and that's it. And we do that with the other, we'll do that with the other sides. I know that they're gonna have the same amount of adjustment. The amount of windage and the amount of elevation in any good scope is gonna be roughly the same. So I just simply wanna unwind this one the same thing. I wanna unwind it 2.5 turns from the bottom. One, two, there we go. So I'm basically centered in both planes. I'm centered in the vertical plane and in the lateral plane. Put your scope caps back on, and if you have a trademark cap, the trademark cap always goes to the windage turret just for looks. Whatever you do, don't lose those turret caps. Stick them in your pocket or something where you're not going to lose them, because I've seen people who've been going around with naked turrets, and it's not a good thing. That exposes those turrets to weather. Unless you've got target turrets, which are weatherproof turrets, you don't want to lose those. You don't want to lose those turrets at all, because that exposes the threads of the turret to weather, and it can really make a mess of things. Be sure that your scope is properly focused for yourself. The very first thing you should do, if it's a nice clear day, or even if it's an overcast day, go outside, set your parallax, if you're using a scope with parallax, set it to infinity, and then set your variable focus to wide open. I think you get the best image of focus if it's wide open, in other words, the widest field of view. So if you've got this happens to be a 4 to 16 variable, so I would set it to 4 power. Go outside, if you wear glasses, if you wear corrective lenses, make sure you're doing it with corrective lenses. In other words, you want to focus to whatever you use. So if you're using corrective lenses, go outside with your corrective lenses, and then look up at the sky, and make adjustments with your crosshair looking at the sky. Turn your focusing dial all the way out. In other words, it can be a ring here, it can be something, a quick focus, sometimes it's a screw lock mechanism, whatever it is, but back it out until the crosshairs become fuzzy, until they lose focus. From that point, now turn it in until looking at the clear sky, turn it in until they become sharp and clear, and then leave it there. You don't want to go beyond the sharp and clear point. You want to start off from fuzzy and turn it in until they're perfectly sharp and clear against the sky, whether it's a clear blue sky or an opaque sky. You don't want to do this adjustment with a target, because the target is going to confuse the image. You're just simply adjusting the focus of the scope. And now you set it infinity. That will automatically, looking at the sky where it is infinity, that will automatically place your objective lens focus or your side focus at the correct distances and in focus. So if you're at 100 yards, your crosshair should be well focused. If you're at 200 yards or whatever in between, the crosshair should be focused. Everything should remain perfect at that point. Now, it's perfectly appropriate if you're at a 100-yard target and you notice that your target is fuzzy or the crosshairs are fuzzy. You can make a fine-tuning adjustment at 100 yards with your turret, with your side adjustment turret or your objective bell screw. You can make a fine adjustment at that point. That's a good time to do that, because once you adjust it at the 100-yard mark, when you know that you're at a set point at 100 yards, you've made that final fine-tuning adjustment, and it'll remain constant. The only problem I have with this particular scope is, it's nice that it has quick focus when I need to make a focusing adjustment, but it doesn't lock into place, and that kind of perturbs me, because without it being locked into place, it's very, very easy for me to bump into this against my clothing or something like that, and to throw me off. If I happen to put my rifle up, it's very, very easy for that to be out of position. So that's a consideration that you have to think about when you're purchasing a scope. If it's a this is a target slash varmint scope, and it's really not a big issue because there's no big deal with varmints. I mean, I can adjust quickly in the field, and I can have plenty of time to do whatever I want before I shoot a woodchuck, or even a coyote. When I'm sitting there getting ready to call them in, I can make sure that all those things are fine. But if it's a deer rifle, if it's something I'm going to be carrying around from one hill to another, that could seriously affect my ability to see if I should bang into that with my coat. So keep it in mind. I mean, even if you have to wrap a piece of black electrical tape around it to keep it steady, that might be something you'll have to do if you're in the field. You know, sometimes practicality has to override aesthetics. So that's the beginning of getting everything adjusted. I've checked my free floating. This gun here, I free floated, so I got plenty of free floating. I can pass a matchbook cover down all the way from beginning to end. Got a good solid scope mounted solidly, focused properly. I'm good to go. So we'll head out to the range. Finally, I recommend that as part of your supplies, you keep yourself a checklist. You know, there's nothing more embarrassing than arriving at the range and forgetting your rifle or forgetting the ammo or targets or something like that. So make sure you have a checklist that you keep handy for all the things that you customarily bring with you. So we got the gun, we got some ammo, I've got my target stand and portable target, my portable shooting bench with the legs, got to have the screw-on legs. And I've got my shooting kit, full targets, and my spotting scope, we're good to go. Betty, let's go shooting. Attaboy. Okay, we're only heading in about a mile or so through relatively heavy wooded country, good deer hunt country around here. And a lot of coyotes, not too many woodchucks these days owing to the coyotes. Pretty good rabbit country, we'll call it rabbit, but they're really varying hares. The coney rabbits have been pretty well wiped out by coyotes and hawks and everything else around here for the last, probably 25 years or more. So we'll catch you on the other side. Benny, what do you say? Starts getting a little bit tough in here, a little bit rough. It hasn't closed in though. There are places that the truck barely gets through. This is no place for a full-size pickup truck unless you really want to get it scratched up. Well, as luck would have it, there heavily logging in the section that I was hoping to go to. They've got it barred off now and they've got some heavy logging equipment in there. So we're just going to have to go in a little deeper to another spot. This is where it gets a little bit tight and bony. Low right now. Quite steep in here. Tough going woods. Right now it's we're having a dry spell, so these brooks, which are normally flooded with water, are pretty dry under the mud. Now we're picking up heavy deer flies. I'm not really crazy about shooting with those buzzing around my head. They're pretty nasty. We'll bang in the head 15 times in a second. keep on moving on. I think that if we keep going, we'll come into a little bit better area. This is where it gets really tight now. The road pretty much disappears at this point. More of a ATV trail. So I'm gonna get my hands on the steering gear here and catch you later. Fisherman down there on a raft. This is a remote mountain pond. And it really is remote. They probably carried that in some ways. This is most definitely moose country, so we'll scan over here and see if we can pick up one feeding over in the bog. Not today, I guess. Black bears around here, a lot of black bears. There's some other people here. It's actually quite seldom that you see anybody over here. This time of year, there's a lot of fishing going on, so we'll get across this. Okay, I just ran across a new logging trail that they've cut. Looks like it's brand new within the last month or so. The guys have gone home for the day. So we'll be able to mount a target up here, 100 yards distant, and that'll be a nice shooting spot. Good backdrop, safe shooting. Okay, there's our first shot right there. We're about almost 3 inches to the left of center, and we're slightly down. I'm not going to concern myself with that small amount of being down, but being 3 inches to the left, that means that at 25 yards we have to multiply all of our clicks by four. In other words, each click that is represented at 100 yards is a quarter of an inch, only moves at a fourth of that distance at 25 yards. So I need four clicks to equal what would be one click at 100. So just using rough count here, we have 3 inches to the left, and we have that would be three fours at 12 clicks if that were 100 yards. But we multiply that times 4, which is 48 clicks. So we want to move 48 clicks right windage. And we can bring it up, probably 12 clicks up, and that would do it. So we need 48 clicks right windage, 12 clicks upward windage. And that should get us pretty close to being, I would say probably about an inch above the center. So here's the setup. We're going to be looking downrange at 100 yards. Actually, we're shooting slight uphill angle. Nothing dramatic enough, more than a degree or two, so we don't have to worry about any calculations concerning uphill elevations. We're going to fire after we set the scope up the way I determined. We're going to go
to remember, we're going to go to the right, 48 clicks. We'll cut back a few clicks because it wasn't quite all the way over to the 3-inch mark. So we'll make it a square 40, and we're going to come up about 16. I would say, well, we got to come up 2 inches. So 2 inches, that's 24 clicks plus a half an inch. We'll call that about 30 clicks or so and see how that goes. So we're going to go right 40 and up about 30 or so. Okay, now, I've made my primary adjustment at 25 from the 25-yard test shot. That was a shot from a cold, clean bore. And the first shot from a cold, clean bore can be somewhat off from the given group location, but it's close enough to get a good start. These loads, by the way, are brand new. It's a load I've never tried before. I've even got them seated to 2.350, which is way shorter than I would normally load them, but because it's a new load that I've never tested before and never tried, I'm going with the Nosler. What they give is a recommended accuracy load for Varget powder. So I'm going to stick with the book on this one to just give me a good starting point. And these are very mild loads. As I say, I had cataract surgery in this right eye just about 12 days ago, so I can't do any heavy lifting. I can't lift anything more than 25 pounds. I've got to be very careful what I do, and recoil is certainly an issue. So I wanted to have a load that reacted very gently on me as I'm doing this. And actually, it's a very fun load to shoot, I'm sure, because it's a mid-range load. It's more like a 223. A little bit more powder than a 223 would require to get the same velocity because it's got a bigger case. But nevertheless, it should go very well. Standard is to try to get as low as you can. This is a pretty solid bench. It doesn't wiggle. It's got iron pipes, and this is solid. This is a solid old door that I laminated. But the whole thing is you want to get as low as you can to provide the best steadiness and the best support. Make sure you've put your side focus, or if you're using a side focus or adjustable objective bell, make sure you have that set at the appropriate distance. Make sure you're focused in, which I am right now. You notice that the stock is sitting on the center of the checkered portion. It's a very, very stiff section of the stock, so there's no upward flex. You don't want to have anything flexing, and you don't want to have the gun bouncing and vibrating off of any surface. You want everything to come back freely into your shoulder. That's the way you get your best field accuracy once you've gotten done sighted in. There's no point in sighting in if what you've done puts your bullets in a different location than what you are in the field. So make sure that you're seated nice and firmly, keep your feet under you, and what we'll do is we'll just fire three shots in succession. Now, unless I see the first shot go really wild, I'm just going to fire three shots in succession. This is a 14 power scope, so I really don't need to have a spotting scope in order to see where I am. So let's see what happens. And by the way, this is not customary. I would not normally pick a location where I'm facing west into the sun this time of day. That sun is going to be a little bit of a problem with the scope, but it's got good lens coatings. I don't get any flare, but nevertheless, this is not the preferred thing. I should be shooting in the other direction, which would be quite unsafe right now because the road is behind me. And it's best to fire one shot at a time and not stack the magazine, because you don't want to have the potential for cramping those bullets any deeper. See how it goes. not sure if I see that. I think it's at 12 o'clock at the top of the diamond, but we're going to get the spotting scope to check it out. I went away for longer than expected. By the time I got back to the truck and returned, the sun, as you can see, has poked up through that cloud and is looking right at me. So it's making a little bit difficult to even find the target with naked eyes, let alone with a scope. So I think we'll try to press on and see what we can do. I located that shot. It was pretty much where I thought it was. So let's keep on going and see what happens, group-wise. I can see that one clearly. Looks like I've got two shots in one hole, and one a little bit higher than that, about 1 minute of angle higher. I've got to come left 1 inch, so simply turn it four clicks to the left. And to give me my 2 inches, I've got to come up about two clicks. We'll come up three. I'm straddling about the inch and a half mark. I really want to be up about two, plus two. That'll put me way out there. See what these do now. Now I've marked where these particular ones have gone, but what I'll do is, rather than shoot on the bullseye, I know that I'm very close, so I'll take a shot at the lower left hand. The lower right hand small target, and see where those go. I just want to come back to the right two clicks and that should do it. Up, go in the wrong direction here. Down, actually, I want to go down one. That'll finish it up. And right two. We'll take a look at the target. This is basically really just fine-tuning. It was sighted in with the first, it was really sighted in with the first three shots. I knew where I needed to make my final adjustments, but you can see how easy that goes. It's just a matter of getting pretty well on target with your first 25-yard shot, calculating your windage and your elevation from the 25-yard shot. That should put you someplace within about 2 or 3 inches around the ballpark, and then you make your final adjustments with this. So actually it came out pretty quickly. I didn't fire too many shots in order to get this whole thing done. So that's as easy as it goes. Check the gun. Everything is clear. We're going to pack it up. It's going to get dark in a minute, and then the bugs and the bears will come out. I don't need to be out here when any of that starts happening. So I'm more concerned with the bugs than I am the bears. The bears will pretty much stay clear, but we also have fishes around here, too. We have, sometimes you hear them screaming. That pond behind me is a habitat for some loons, and you hear them about now. So we're going to pack up. I'll meet you up at the target. Okay, there was my first shot right there. And after we made the crude adjustment, we came over to this point here. There are two shots in one of those holes. I'm not sure which one it is. And then finally, this was my final group, which is up two. Yeah, it's about up 2.5 inches. And remember, I brought it back to the right approximately. Well, I brought it back to the right 2 clicks and one down. I think that would pretty much do it. That bench is not the sturdiest. There's a little bit of shake in that bench. I can see my pulse through the scope. So that is an extremely good accurate load for the first time that I've tried it, and that's seated way too deeply. I've got those seated buried in the case to 2.350 according to specs. They're probably going to come out about close to a quarter of an inch by the time I'm done. That will near the rifling. So that's going to increase the accuracy, I'm sure. But that's a heck of a fun load. Very accurate, very low recoil, kind of quieted. It kind of reminds me a little bit of a 222. Not exactly. It's still pumping them out there at 223 velocities. That's it. See you back at the barn. And this has a way out on the far other side of town. But at this point, it's the preferred way to go, and it's only about, it's less than a mile from here to get out onto the main road. So that's where we're going. We've just got a bridge to cross here, so I'm going to sign off because this bridge, I don't want to be going over the side of it. Take care. Before we can call ourselves done now for the day, there are a few housekeeping chores to take care of before we forget what we've done. It's always a good thing to know what sort of groups your rifle is shooting rather than trying to memorize these things, because you may have more than one load. And remember, whatever sighting in you accomplished was only for that particular load or that particular brand or that particular bullet weight. They may, generally speaking, most loads will not be, you cannot call one sight in sufficient for all loads you're going to shoot in that rifle. So this particular load right here, edge to edge, is 0.770. So that would be center to center. Now another way of measuring center to center is edge to edge. In other words, same edge to same edge. That's a more accurate way than trying to find the center. And you don't measure groups from widest point. In other words, from the outside of the bullet hole. So that's it. That's not a very bad group at all, but that's certainly not what this rifle has been capable of in the past. This is a very reduced load for this
for this rifle, as I said earlier, and I haven't yet fine-tuned it. And also, too, as I said, I could see the pulse. That's a very sturdy bench, but it's certainly nothing like a concrete bench or anything like that, which has no movement whatsoever. There's a little bit of discernible movement, which was probably as much as 3/8 of an inch, which could have thrown some of these shots wide. But anyway, I'm not going to apologize for that particular load. That's a very nice shooting group. So I made the final adjustments, which brought it back over to center and then down just a little bit, because I only wanted to be up 2.1 inches really. And now there's a couple of other things we need to do. First of all, we want to make an assessment of the cartridge cases and see how they look to make sure that everything is within acceptable standards, and they should certainly be, because this is a reduced load. The other thing we want to do is make sure that our turret screws are set to zero. So let's see how we do that. Okay, most decent scopes will have provisions to set your turrets to zero. That allows you to be able to return to a particular setting without having to remember what the dial said before you began. In other words, you just turn the, if you decided that you wanted to use this as a bullet drop compensation feature, because all turrets can be used in that way. You don't need to buy BDC or spend extra money to buy BDC in order to do that. You can adjust for windage, so many clicks, so many MOA, and then return it back the way it was just by spinning it back to zero. So anyway, how you do that on scopes differs from one brand to another. This is a Nikon. As you can see, it's got a slot here. That slot is made for, you could use a cartridge case rim, but it specifically fits just the head of a nickel. So before you start turning that, take note of where you are, where your hash marks are on your turret. This one here happens to have a micrometer. I don't know if you can see that, but if you look up underneath the turret, you can see there's vernier scales. There's a vernier line that goes around for each full turn. So this one here happens to be at the number 2 position, and it also reads 11 on the. It also reads 11 on the vernier. So in other words, it's 2.11. So all I need to do is hold the dial firmly so that it doesn't turn, and then remove that screw. And after you remove the screw, be careful, sometimes these screws are very, very easy to drop. You don't want to drop it into the grass. They're small oftentimes, and they're not something you can find at a hardware store. Now, once the screw is removed, very frequently the cap will just simply pop right off like that. Now, around the side, you can see there are marks that indicate in numerals, and as I say, each brand has its own system, but this is fairly typical. What I'm looking for is the zero mark on this. Once I found that, just align that with my reference point on the vernier. Now you can see the vernier scale on this turret very nicely. Let's see if I can bring it up. But you can see the marks along it, and then there's a vertical line. That's what I want to line up with my turret cap, with the vernier dial. So once I've done that, place that down onto position. Now I don't have to worry about returning to zero if I should try a different load or something like that, and I decide to go back to this load. So that's a very handy feature. Now I'll take care of the other one off camera. What the other thing that we want to do before we finish up our housekeeping is to check out our brass and see how the ammo fared during the testing. And of course, you know, if you're working with top loads, you want to be doing that at the bench while you're shooting, because you don't want to find yourself shooting loads which are excessive in pressure. These were minimum loads for that particular powder. And in looking at them, I discovered that the primers are popped out just a little bit. Now that is indicative, and that's normal for a reduced charge. Some people get confused by that. They think that this means that the load was excessive. An excessive load would mean a blown primer. This is not a blown primer. This is a primer which is backed out by the headspace amount. Let me explain that. I think I mentioned this in one of the other videos about pressure. But at the instant of firing, the case is pressed forward into the chamber by the distance of the head spacing, which is several thousandths of an inch. And in other words, by the firing pin, it's driven forward. And at that point, the firing pin discharges the primer. Normally, the primer will back out, and then the case will follow it and reseat itself. But in this case here, the primer backed out during the firing, but the charge was not sufficient enough to press the case back against the bolt face. What this actually means is that this case would literally last forever, because except for maybe work hardening, but it's not stretching, because normally when it comes back, it's stretching by that amount of headspace. And eventually it will create, it always stretches at the web, at the area just forward of the rim, about a quarter of an inch forward of the rim. So in this particular case here, the head did not stretch back and meet the bolt face. It just simply stayed there. The front of the case expanded and hugged the chamber, and it just didn't expand. So I'm probably working with very, very low pressures here. So that's fine, and it's a very nice, easy shooting load, and seems quite accurate. So if I wanna for whatever reason use a 223 style load in my 22-250, this is an excellent one to go with. That's why the 22-250 has frequently been called by different people over the years a versatile cartridge. Not too many cartridges that can do that. You can't step down the 220 Swift too much before it loses all accuracy. So that's it. Thank you for watching, and God bless.